Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome back to another episode of the Pieper Sports Podcast. We have a wonderful, wonderful guest today by the name of Conor McGahey.
Hello, good people of Pepsi Center, and welcome to Hockey Night in Colorado.
Here's John Grant Jr. Shoots! Scores! History has been made!
The Avalanche play-by-play caller on Altitude Radio.
Well, my name's Conor McGahey. I'm the play-by-play voice of the Colorado Avalanche, mainly on radio, occasionally on television. And today, here in San Jose, California, ahead of game number 7 between the Avalanche and the San Jose Sharks. The Avs fought their way back down 3-2, a game 6 overtime win, courtesy of Gabriel Landeskog. And now the Sharks have to play back-to-back series with 7 games, but it's good to be on with you today.
Yeah, I appreciate your willingness to be on the show. I'm pretty sure you're very, very busy going into game 7. I was at game 6. It is an electrifying atmosphere. Definitely the Avalanche fans have shown their loudness and their voice to the San Jose Sharks. I'm pretty sure the NBCSN is pretty pretty jealous of what the Avs are putting out there, breaking records. Have you seen the statistic that the Avalanche have broken, or the Colorado market has broken, the ratings record for NBCSN at that time with an 8.1 rating?
Yeah, and they even did one better. They did 8.1 at that time, and then the best ever in the market at a 9.2 in back-to-back game.
So, was it 9.2?
So they even did a point better. And so they continue to shatter some records as far as watching hockey. So the city is into it. The surrounding area is into it, and they should be. This is a team that, yes, is on a playoff run now, but given the players involved, should be players in the Western Conference as a group for years to come.
So would you consider yourself to be one of the representatives of Colorado on the national scale?
Well, yeah, I think so. I mean, I'm lucky enough to be born and raised in Colorado. I grew up in Breckenridge and went to the University of Denver, and have been working inside Denver sports pretty much ever since I was in college. And so not a lot of people get to do that, to work in an environment and in a job that they want to be in, especially in the sports landscape, all pretty much in their hometown. So it's a very fortunate on my part, and I get some opportunities to talk about the city and the state, and of course this team on a couple of different outlets. And so that makes, very lucky, and hopefully represent our city and our state and our team pretty well.
How does it feel going into San Jose, if you're the Colorado Avalanche? How does it feel going into Game 7 after coming back and winning it in Game 6, tying up the series? What do you feel like if you are Gabriel Landeskog, Nathan Mackinnon? What is your responsibility?
Well, I think that you feel like you've been playing these type games for 2 months now. You've been basically playing elimination games ever since St. Patrick's Day. They had back-to-back losses on March 11th and March 15th versus the Carolina Hurricanes and the Anaheim Ducks. Ever since then, they really turned it on and knew that if they were to sort of get back into losing habits, they wouldn't be in the postseason. And so they went on that magical run, and they played in Game 81 and were able to beat the Winnipeg Jets at home and get into the postseason for the second year in a row. So this sort of game is not unfamiliar to them. So this is not going to freak anybody out. They played an elimination game in Game number 6 and were able to handle the pressure despite all the San Jose Sharks' comebacks. And I expect them to do the exact same in Game number 7. I think the top line in particular will want to be better. Before that overtime, collectively, they were minus 9. And that's not where they want to be at. But when it comes down to it, especially in overtime, the Avs are 3-0. The 3 overtime game winners, Nathan Mackinnon, Mikko Rantanen, and Gabriel Landeskog. So I would expect them as a group, despite the Sharks' efforts, and they've done a nice job all series of shutting down that top line. But I expect the three of them to hopefully lead by example here tonight in a winner-take-all Game 7.
Absolutely. Fantastic job out there by the Colorado Avalanche. What are your opinions on Cale Makar and the effect he has put on the game so far? He's close to leading defenseman in points. He had the assist on the overtime goal in Game 6. What is Cale Makar's impact on this series?
Well, for Cale Makar, I mean, he is a special player. He's a player that obviously has shown up in the middle of a playoff run, scored his first NHL goal on his first NHL shot in his first NHL period, and it happened to be the game-winning goal. So now he has, including that assist to Gabriel Landeskog the other night, a game-winning goal and three game-winning assists inside the Stanley Cup playoffs. He's a player that sees the game differently than everybody else. He is extremely intelligent, has beyond hockey sense, and he has a skill set that can keep up with his brain, which is what makes him so dangerous. So imagine what he can do when he continues to learn lessons on how to defend and how to really improve his game on a regular basis. I mean, he is a difference maker on the ice out there right now, and he's only been around a couple games in the National Hockey League. This is going to be the type of player who will be a superstar in the National Hockey League for years to come. Excuse me, he really is something special.
Absolutely. And talking about the development of players, a little bit of a shift, but talking about Nathan Mackinnon. Ever since the Matt Duchene trade, it has appeared that Nathan Mackinnon has really hit that higher tier, that upper echelon, elite level of play. Would you say that after the Matt Duchene trade, that Nathan Mackinnon was actually able to reach his full potential with the Colorado Avalanche?
I would still argue, and he would probably agree, that he hasn't reached his full potential yet. He can still go beyond the achievements that he's had, and that's win playoff series and win trophies inside the playoffs. For Nathan Mackinnon, I think that was an instance where he was freed up a little bit to really take hold of a team and take control. But for him, he's an extremely competitive player and holds himself pretty accountable and wants to be the best at all times. And when you have that sort of attitude, you continue to strive for stardom because he wants to be in those conversations when you're talking about the superstars of the National Hockey League. When you talk about Conor McDavid and Austin Matthews and Sidney Crosby, Nathan Mackinnon wants to be among those names mentioned when you talk about the best that this game has to offer.
Absolutely. And where would you rank Nathan Mackinnon out of all players in the NHL? Of course, for me, you know, Connor McDavid is that, you know, superstar generational talent at the top of the list. Where would Nathan Mackinnon rank right now as it stands?
I mean, he's up there. I mean, he's a top three player in the National Hockey League, I would say, because of every single piece of his game. We talked about his speed. He's a right-handed shot, one of only two Avs forwards that are a right-handed shot. But his stick handling ability is insane. He's improved his one-timer this year, trying to emulate Alexander Ovechkin. This is another name, that we always talk about as far as NHL greats. And then his physical presence. I mean, it goes unmentioned a lot, but Nathan Mackinnon is actually and can be a very physical player. And so for him, he really has a lot of tools in the toolbox. So when I look around the NHL, he's definitely a top three player for me. And in that conversation, and I'm among those list of names, when you talk about the greatest players that our game has to offer, and Pierre LeBrun of The Athletic had a great piece last week about how he talked to Patrick Kane, another superstar, talked to Sidney Crosby, talked to Connor McDavid, guys who are out of the postseason now and who are watching Nathan Mackinnon on TV and really getting a chance to step back from having to play against him and just watch him play the game of hockey and see how good he really is. Mark Giordano said at the end of the Calgary series that he is one of, if not the toughest player he's ever had to defend, and he is, in fact, a superstar. So those type of compliments are coming from your contemporaries, from the players that you're playing against, that is always the highest level of praise when those compliments come from that source.
No, absolutely. I think Nathan Mackinnon has shown that he is one of the top talents and one of the best players, one of the best superstars in the NHL, one of the most humble egos in the league as well. Being so close to the team, do you have a different feel? Does this team feel different? Do they have this special ring to them? How far can this team genuinely make it?
Well, they can go as far as they want to go. And the belief has been there, as we mentioned, for a couple months. The belief is there. They have the personalities, and they have the talent that they can go. And the good news is that if they don't go this year, they are learning lessons on a second-by-second basis that they can apply to future playoff runs. And I know that everyone wants to grab the present as much as possible, but the guys in there are a special group, and they don't panic. They don't overthink things. A lot of them are instinctual hockey players, which is a good trait to have, especially inside the Stanley Cup playoffs. So sometimes you need the hockey gods to be on your side, though, when you're going through a playoff run. We'll see if that's the case tonight in Game 7 versus San Jose.
Absolutely. Game 7 will be a hard-hitting, fast-paced game in San Jose, 7 p.m. tonight. It'll be a hell of a game. I'm excited for it. A few more questions talking about the future of the Colorado Avalanche and the NHL. I wrote a piece a few days ago talking about what this NHL playoffs, the 2019 NHL playoffs, means for the future. Obviously, all the number one seeds get knocked out for the first time in a long time. It's a very, very random feeling, but definitely it's a good feeling in the playoffs. What are your opinions on the parity that's going on and the teams that are currently, you know, continuing through the playoffs?
Well, the parity is what makes the NHL one of, if not the best league to watch, especially. That's the bad rap that the NBA gets, especially over the past half decade, almost a decade. Oh, it's the Cavs and the Warriors again. But for the NHL, I mean, you had, at least for a time, a possibility of having all four wildcard teams be your conference finalists. Obviously, Dallas losing last night and Columbus the night before has taken that possibility away. But it's kept alive by the Colorado Avalanche and the Carolina Hurricanes. And I think parity is important because, as Commissioner Gary Bettman said, he said, what fans want every single year is to believe they have a chance to win and be successful. And I think that's true inside the National Hockey League more than anywhere else. And that's embodied by the Colorado Avalanche. 2 years ago, the worst season that we've seen in the National Hockey League in recent memory, and now back-to-back playoff appearances. So any other sport, that sort of turning of the ship may have taken a lot longer than it does in the National Hockey League. I think it's important for viewers and for fans, and I think that it's good because it also keeps players on the ice accountable, because unlike the old days where you could walk through some teams in some cities and count some games as a win, you can't do that anymore. Every single game matters, and that's important for the product on the ice and what you see on television, and perhaps more importantly, here on radio.
Absolutely. And by the way, I love your radio calls. I've listened to many games because, you know, I live kind of far away from Denver, but I go to school downtown. Listening to the radio and Avs games is something that kind of gets me through that drive going home. You do a fantastic job. What does the transfer from television to radio feel like?
Well, I always jokingly call radio the McHale's Navy of broadcasting, because we get to, you know, it's a little bit looser, have a little bit more fun, but there's more descriptors, as we know, and you have to remember that people cannot see unless they are muting the television and listening to you along with watching the television feed. But for the most part, if you're driving like you are to and from home, or, you know, We have listeners all over the place. We've had oil workers in Prudhoe Bay, Alaska, listening in. We had somebody at McMurdo Station in Antarctica who's working on a science project while listening to the ads. They can't see the action. And so their emotions are always hanging in the balance because they can't see. So they're relying on what we're able to do to bring them the game and the team that they love. With TV, you have to remember that people can see. You don't have to insult their intelligence. But with radio, there has to be more descriptors. And usually with that becomes, it becomes more emotion, we'll say. And so we turn into and our fans, along with everybody else, as we're doing the games. So we ride the highs and the lows along with everybody else who's listening out there.
Absolutely. And just kind of a quick question of how you your feelings on I've heard rumblings that people are muting the TVs for the NBC SN broadcasts and turning on your radio broadcasts as their audio. How does that make you feel?
Well, I mean, it's a great compliment. I know that everyone at NBC are true professionals. They're great at their craft. They are great human beings, and they have to do their broadcast a certain way. We have the benefit of doing it from an Avalanche perspective, and that's why it's very neat that people want to tune in and again go along with the highs and lows that we were just describing, while also watching the game. So the guys at NBCSN are good people. They really are. And like I said, they have to call the game through a different lens than we do. But I think as Avalanche fans, we can all get together and enjoy the game how we want. So I'm thankful for everyone who tunes in and even does that on a regular basis.
Absolutely. And tonight is going to be one of the most exciting games of the season, obviously a final game for the Colorado Avalanche. It's going to be a fun one today, 7 p.m. Mountain Standard Time in San Jose. I'd like to thank you for your time, Connor. It's an absolute wonder talking to you. You're a fantastic guy and do fantastic stuff over the radio. Hopefully can do some stuff with you in the future. But I would love to thank you for your time and thank you for the opportunity to speak to you.
No, it is my pleasure. I'm just trying to be like you. That's all. No, happy to be on.